Well, good morning. Welcome to Mariners. I'm so glad that you're here. Let's stand together and let's look at God's word before we begin worshiping and singing together. Psalm 145 says this: Great is the Lord, most worthy of praise. His greatness no one can fathom. One generation commends your works to another. They tell of your mighty acts. We gather this morning, every generation, to declare the greatness and the goodness of our God. He is great and greatly to be praised. Come on, let's put our hands together.
Done great things. Oh, hero of doubt. Let love invade, let the church live loud. Our God will save, we believe, we believe. Let the lost be found and the dead be raised in the here and now. Let love invade, let the church live loud. Our God will save, we believe, we believe. In the gates of hell will not prevail, for the power of God has torn the veil. And we know your love will never fail. We believe, we believe, we believe in God the Father. We believe in Jesus Christ. We believe in the Holy Spirit, and he's given us. Coming back again, we believe. Oh, oh. Yeah. Oh, we God who lives in us.
the same power that conquered the grave, that raised Jesus from the grave, is the same power that lives inside of me. I shout that truth this morning. I shout his name, Yahweh, the God who is present, the God who has promised that he will be with you, because at those times when I need his presence, I know he is there with me. When, in the book of Exodus, when Moses is actually standing before God in the form of a burning bush, speaking to him, this is where God reveals for the first time, Yahweh, I am who I am, which is to say, I promise to be with you. I promise to go with you. And here's Moses saying, God, I'm not the leader that you're calling me to be. I'm not a good leader. He came up with every excuse. I'm afraid. I'm not a good public speaker. And what was interesting as I was reading that is that God never addressed the problem. He never addressed Moses' concern. He just said, I promise to be with you. He never addressed the problem. He just gave a promise. In Isaiah 43, verse 2, it says, when you pass through the waters, I will be with you. And when you pass through the rivers, they will not sweep over you. When you walk through the fire, you will not be burned. The flames will not set you ablaze. I want to encourage somebody this morning that your prayer has looked something like this. God, would you take away my depression? Would you take away my anxiety? Would you take away my addiction? Would you take away, just give me a new job. Like, I need a new job. Like, would you take away the current job I have and give me a new job? Would you give me a break from the tension in my relationships, the tension in a family, the tension in a marriage? Would you take this problem away? And God's not addressing your problem. He's simply saying, I will be with you. I will be with you. I will be with you to give you the grace and the love when you fail. I'll be with you to give you the faith to follow when it doesn't make sense. I will be with you and give you peace that passes all understanding. I will be with you. The same God on the mountain is the same God in the valley. And yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me. We can take courage, we can take rest, we can take comfort in the fact of knowing that we do not walk this faith and this journey alone. He is our comforter. And he is with you this morning. Whatever challenge, whatever season you're in, he is with you this morning. A season of grief, a season of sorrow, a season of celebration, the Lord is with you this morning. So I want to give you a moment. And this is your time to just say, God, thank you for being with me. Thank you that I'm not alone. Thank you that you have not left me. Thank you that you have given your presence, and that is a promise that I hold on to this morning. So right now, this is your time. Talk to the Lord.
In every situation you're good. Oh, even when I don't feel you, you are still on your throne and you're good. You're still on your throne and you're good. Oh, you're a good father. You are loving, you are always faithful, always kind, always compassionate. Oh, if you know he's been faithful, just lift your hands. If he's been good, just lift your hands and say thank you. Tell him thank you. Oh, that you never leave me. You never left me alone. Oh, we thank you for your presence. Oh, for the promise. That you are good, good. Oh, yes, you are good, good. You are good. Oh, you are good, good. Oh.
Oh, would you clap your hands because you know he's good? It's good to worship together and in his house this morning, amen. The presence of God is sweet in this place. We have a good God who loves us, who walks us through many difficult and challenging seasons and hard seasons. And sometimes I think about the practice of hearing God's voice. And sometimes I think I hear God's voice more in the destination of like, God, I'm praying for this specific thing. And then he answers that. But the more that I've walked with Jesus, the more that I realize that it's not what I get at the end of the journey, but it's the journey and what God teaches me along the way. And that I know that he's faithful, but he wants to show us his faithfulness. I know that he's good, but he wants to show us his goodness. I pray that you would experience the goodness of God this morning. There's some beautiful people all around this room. Why don't you give somebody a high five, let them know your name, hug on somebody. Welcome to Mariners.
Mariners Church, I hope that you're having an amazing weekend. My name's Joe Hayes, I'm the experienced pastor here, and I'm so glad that you're a part of our online audience today. It's my hope that you would be a part of a thriving church community. And if there is anything that I can do to help you get connected, to answer any questions that you have, or to look for opportunities to serve, or to get involved, or even if you have any prayer requests, you can email me at onlinepastor@marinerschurch.org. I'd love to connect with you, and I hope that you have a great week.
Well, good morning, everybody. Good to be with you today. I'm Trisha Graves, and I love getting to worship with you, my church family. There are so many great things going on at Mariners, and if this is your first time here, we want to say welcome. We are glad that you're here. We have a lot of people out on the patio. We have a welcome center, and we just want to say hello and get to know you a little better. So if this is your first time here today, if you would come out to the Welcome Center, we'd love to share with you how to get involved and the many ways that you can get connected here at Mariners. And speaking of getting connected, we had about 900 people last night at our Marriage Matters event, couples connecting with other couples. We learned some fun stuff about our new senior pastor, Eric Geiger, and his wife, Kay, who's the grumpiest in the morning, who has given each other food poisoning. But we have all sorts of fun on Saturday nights. And if you have never tried Saturday nights, we want to encourage you to give it a try. We've planned all sorts of great stuff. So you can come to service on Saturday and then stay after. Next week is a worship and prayer night after the Saturday night service. And when you come to Saturday night, you are opening up a spot for someone to come and hear about Jesus on Sunday morning. So we want to invite you guys to a Saturday night service. Also, many of you give generously every weekend, and we thank you for that. We have offering boxes in the back of the sanctuary. And one of the things that God has been challenging me with is what it looks like to honor him first. And there's a verse in Proverbs 3:9, and it says, "Honor the Lord with your possessions and with the first produce of your entire harvest." And I love that scripture because I love that word honor. Because when we give in our offering, we're honoring God out of the wealth that he has already given to us. And secondly, when we give in our offerings and tithes, it is a demonstration of our trust in Jesus, that he has already provided for us all that we need. And so we want to encourage you to give as a regular giver and to watch what God does with your heart as you trust him with your finances. Also, next week, we are starting a new series, the best chapter ever. And this section over here is going to be hopping because our high schoolers are going to come and join us. We'll be joining us for the next 5 weeks. And then we've got a great youth night planned for them on Sunday night. So we're excited about that. And let me have you look at the screens as we talk a little bit more about what the series is going to entail.
You are not condemned. You are led by the Spirit. You are a child of God. You have a future glory. You are secure in Christ. Don't miss God's great promises for you from Romans 8. Best chapter ever.
And I'm so excited for us to get to learn from Romans 8 together. It brings me back to when I was a new believer. I had a leader that sat with me every week for several months as we learned about justification and the role of the Holy Spirit and the gift of eternal salvation through Romans 8. And so this is one of those chapters. There's something for everybody. And also, if there are people in your life who need to be here to learn about some foundations of the Christian faith, we want you to invite them. So in the back of the room are some little invitation cards. So invite somebody that needs to come and learn out of Romans 8. Also, invite some high schoolers to come and join you and join us as well at youth nights on Sunday nights. There's some info in your bulletin about that. But now, we get to hear from our senior pastor, who's going to share with us what you get to hear today. And so he's on video with us. So take a look.
Good morning, Mariners. Last night at our Saturday night service, it was incredible. I enjoyed worshiping alongside our crew on Saturday nights. And this morning, I'm teaching at our Huntington Beach congregation. And I'm really excited to introduce a friend of mine who's going to be teaching here this morning. His name is Halim Suh. And Halim is the teaching pastor at Austin Stone Church in Austin, Texas, which is a great church. And it's a church that I've had a relationship with for the last 10 years. And so do me a favor and welcome my friend Halim as he comes to teach us God's word this morning. Welcome him.
All right, it's good to be with you, Mariners Church. It's an honor for me to be here, as Eric said. Serve as one of the pastors and elders at the Austin Stone Community Church down there in Texas. And your pastor, Eric, he's been such a great friend, such a great mentor to our church over the years. And so I've been praying this week that at least in some small measure I could return the favor by opening up God's word for us this week. And so before we do that, let's pray together. Father, you say to us to seek your face. So our hearts say to you, your face, O Lord, do we seek. You give us life. You give us breath. You give us everything. Church, will you pray and right now in this time make that your confession, that you're here seeking his face, that you want to know him. That the reason why you're here breathing today, alive today, is because he has given you life. He has given you breath. He upholds all things by the word of his power. That means that if even for a moment he would pause to be mindful of us, we would cease to exist. You're here today. You're alive today. You're breathing and thinking today because he's thinking about you. He's mindful of you. Will you pray for your brothers and sisters in Christ to your right and to your left? We don't know what kind of day they're having. We don't know what kind of week they've had. We don't know the burdens that they're carrying. Will you pray in this time that nothing less would happen in this place, in this time, than them meeting with Jesus? Will you pray that God would open their eyes to see, give them ears to hear, and a heart to comprehend this great gospel? Father, we thank you that you are a God who is not silent. You are a God who speaks. You are a God who desires to be known and desires your word to be known so much that you wrote it down for us. Father, we ask that you would speak in this time by your word, by the power of your Holy Spirit. Lord, we ask you in Jesus' name, amen. I want to share something with you from the most famous sermon ever preached, Eric's last sermon. Most famous sermon ever preached, Jesus' Sermon on the Mount, recorded for us in Matthew chapters 5 through 7. Jesus' Sermon on the Mount marks the beginning of his public ministry. And he starts out his sermon with a series of sayings that all have this theme of a blessedness. You might know it as the Beatitudes. I'm sure it's familiar to many of you. Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they shall be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they shall inherit the earth. And there are eight of these Beatitudes, right? Blessed are those. Blessed are those. It comes from the Greek word makarios, which can also be translated as happy. And so happy are those. Blessed are those. Over and over and over again. What is the truly blessed life? Where can we find true blessing and flourishing and happiness, right? The whole world is looking for this. We're looking for this. And Jesus is telling us where it can be found. He's not trying to hide it from us. And think about this. Jesus is starting out his ministry in this way, by teaching us where blessing and happiness can be found. And what is this showing us? This is showing us that Jesus isn't after a mediocre life for you. He's not content with you living a mundane life. He's not content with you having just a run-of-the-mill level of happiness. If you think that the call to Christianity is a call to some bland, muted experience, you don't know yet what it means to be a Christian. You don't know yet what it means to be called into this community called the church of God. Jesus is so concerned with you being blessed. Jesus is so concerned with you being happy that he starts out his ministry in this way. Christians ought to be the happiest people on earth, right? We ought to be the happiest people on earth. Jesus is so concerned about it. So Jesus is teaching us that true happiness and blessing can be found in this life, but it's so countercultural. How he says it will be found. It's so otherworldly. It's so different than the way that we would most naturally try to pursue it in this world. If you read through the eight Beatitudes, you'll see that Jesus is teaching us that true happiness, true blessing, not the counterfeit kind, not the kind that comes and goes with every changing circumstance, but the unshakable kind, right? That is found in being poor in spirit. That is found in mourning our sins, that is found in being meek and hungering and thirsting for righteousness. Countercultural, isn't it? He's saying to us, you want to be happy, you want to be blessed, well, you have to be poor, you have to weep, you have to cry, you have to hunger, you have to thirst. Isn't it incredible? We all desperately want to be happy, right? But many of us are running away from the very things that Jesus has taught us will yield a true happiness and blessing. Next four Beatitudes. Jesus teaches us that the true blessing and happiness is promised to the merciful, to the merciful, to the pure in heart, to the peacemakers. And listen to this, to those who are persecuted by the world for loving and obeying this person named Jesus. He says, rejoice and be glad when you are persecuted for loving me and following me by this world, for your reward is great in heaven. The Beatitudes are a description of God's people. It's a description. It's important to note that the Beatitudes are not a to-do list. It's not God saying, unless you live this way, I'm not going to save you. No, it's I've saved you. You're mine, and because you're mine, you're going to live this way. It's not a, hey, I've saved you, remember, and so will you please live in this way? No, it's a declaration over his people. It's I've saved you. I've delivered you out of sin and darkness. I've poured my grace upon you. I've given you my very Holy Spirit. The old is gone. The new has come. And so now you will live this way. And so now my people will live in this way. It's a declaration over us. That's Matthew 5, 1 through 12, the Beatitudes by way of introduction, because today I want us to focus on the next verse, verse 13. What does Jesus have to say about a people like this? His people, his church, living in accord with the Beatitudes. He says, Matthew 5, verse 13, you are the salt of the earth. You are the salt of the earth. But if salt has lost its taste, how shall its saltiness be restored? It is no longer good for anything except to be thrown out and trampled under people's feet. And so to a people living out and aspiring to live out these Beatitudes, to us, his church, Jesus says, you are the salt of the earth. Mariners Church, you are the salt of the earth. He tells us that we are the salt of the earth, but what does that mean? What does that mean? That's kind of a strange thing to call somebody, right? You're salt. What does that mean? Well, at least these three things. When he calls us salt, first, he's teaching us that God's people are to be distinct and set apart from the world. Distinct and set apart from the world. But second, at the same time, we are not to separate ourselves from the world. Set apart from the world, but not to separate ourselves from the world. And number three, so that we might change the world and influence the world for Christ. By calling us salt, Jesus is teaching us to be distinct from the world, but not to separate from the world, so that we might change the world. Or as your mission statement says, so that we might fearlessly change the world. First, when Jesus calls us the salt of the earth, he's calling us to be a distinct and set apart people from the rest of the world. But before we get into that, let's talk a little bit about salt. Salt is one of the most, if not the most, common household commodity, right? I'm sure every single one of us have salt in our homes. In our day, we use salt primarily for a seasoning, but before the days of refrigeration, salt was critical in preserving meat, preserving fish from decaying. Salt was the Frigidaire of the ancient world. When salt is rubbed into the meat, right, it does two things. It acts both to make the meat savory, right? Makes the meat taste good, but it also acts as a preservative. It's an antiseptic. It preserves the meat from decaying. The metaphor Jesus is using is to say that we, his people, when we're dispersed into the world like salt, when we are scattered and rubbed into the societies of this world, that we're going to act both to bring out the best in that culture. We're going to bring out the savoriness of the culture, and we're going to prevent it from its worst tendencies. We're going to act as a preservative, but only if salt is salt, distinct and different from the thing that's decaying. If we're the same as the thing that's decaying, we won't be of any help. We will be of no use, Jesus says. And so can this be said of you, church, in the neighborhood that you're living in, the places where you work, schools that you're attending? Can it be said of you that simply because you're there and you're living as salt, you're living out your Christianity, that your neighborhood is better? Can your coworkers say this of you? That man, because you're there, because you sit right there, right? Because of your life, you bring out the best in me. Can your friends this say of you? Can your friends say, because you're in my life, you prevent me. I want you to know that you prevent me from my worst tendencies. I want you to know that my life is better because you're my friend. Can your husband, can your wife say this of you? I want you to know that you bring out my best. Do we bring out the best in our spouse? We know how to bring out their worst, right? But do we know how to bring out their best? And that's what salt does. What is salt? It's the chemical compound sodium chloride, right? When sodium comes together with chloride, that's when you have salt. I minored in chemistry. I almost flunked out, but I remember that. You know, as an Asian, it's really difficult to admit that to you, that I flunked out of chemistry. But I did. I'm trying to be open and vulnerable and honest with you. So when sodium and chloride come together, that's when you have salt. And so is the Christian, don't you see? When a sinner is met with grace, when the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ comes in contact and bonds with the sinner, that's when you have a Christian, okay? In so many ways, we're just like the world. We're all sinners, right? But the difference is, the critical difference of the Christian is not that we're better in any way, not that we're smarter, not that we're more morally pure. The critical difference is that the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ has met with us, right? The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ has been met by the sinner, and that's when you have a Christian. Jesus is saying the whole earth, in its present condition, with its present culture and standards and values, is decaying because of sin, because of its rejection of Jesus. Don't you see it? Don't you feel it, right? But Jesus is saying, you church, you mariners, are the salt of the earth. You can keep it from decaying. And more than that, you can bring out its best. And notice Jesus says, you are the salt. Says you are the salt. The verb is indicative, not imperative. Notice Jesus doesn't say you need to be the salt of the earth. Notice he doesn't say, I want you to really try to be the salt of the earth. He says you are the salt of the earth. He's speaking to our identity. In other words, we're not trying to live a certain way because we're trying to be God's sons, because we're trying to be God's daughters, but we're called to live a certain way because we are God's sons and daughters, right? My wife, Angela, and I, we have four kids, and our youngest name is Ben. He's 4 years old, like the squishiest, happiest little guy ever. If you could imagine the Pokemon Pikachu looking like a Korean little boy, that's what he looks like, okay? We adopted Ben from Korea almost 3 years ago now. And imagine if we saw Ben just about obeying everything that Angela and I told him to do. He doesn't do that, but let's just say he was obeying everything that we told him to do. And I would say, Ben, my goodness, what's going on? Thank you so much for obeying Mama and Appa. And what if he were to say to me, I'm obeying because I'm trying to be your son. What if he were to say, I'm obeying because I'm trying to be your son? Well, that would absolutely crush me, right? Every time I would see him obey, it would crush me. But if he were to look at me and he were to say, of course I'm obeying. I'm your son. You're my appa. Well, that would absolutely melt me. I'd be like, what you want? You want some ice cream? You want Nintendo Switch? Sign on to Amazon. Let's go. Church, many of you, you're saved. God saved you. You're a Christian, and you're desperately trying to obey, desperately trying to live a certain way because you're saying, God, I'm trying my best here. I'm trying my best to be your son. I'm trying my best to be your daughter. But don't you see, that's absolutely crushing to the heart of God. He wants to say to you today, no, you are my son. You are my daughter in whom I am well pleased. And of course, I am calling you to live a certain way, but I'm calling you to live a certain way, not so that you can be my son, not so that you can be my daughter, but I'm calling you to live a certain way because you are my son, because you are my daughter. Jesus is saying, as sons and daughters of God, we are the salt of the earth. And so in light of the fact that we are his sons and daughters, in light of the fact that we are the salt of the earth, how then is he calling us to live? as a church, as a people of God? What does biblically salty living look like in this world? Well, Jesus taught us already in the Beatitudes. He says we are to be poor in spirit. Poor in spirit, not rich. When the world says, when the rest of the world says, I'm able, I can do it, I have the inner strength, I have what it takes, I don't need anyone to save me, the Christian says, I'm unable. I can't do it apart from Christ. In and of myself, I can do nothing, I can earn nothing. All that I have because of grace. I desperately need somebody to save me. We are people who mourn our sins instead of celebrating our self-righteousness. We're people who mourn the sins in this world. We're not an apathetic people. Christians are not an apathetic people. We don't ignore sin. We don't relativize sin. We don't say, oh, my sin's not as bad as theirs, and so it's okay. We don't make compromises with sin. We don't surrender to sin. We don't say, oh, I've been struggling and fighting this sin for so long, but there's been no victory. I guess life's just gonna be this way. No, we mourn our sins and the sins in this world. See, many of us, we know how to mourn the consequences of sin, right? But when's the last time you sat before God, confessed your sins, and mourned? Christians are a meek people. We're not a weak people, we're a meek people. In Christ, we have incredible strength. The spirit of him who raised Christ Jesus from the dead also dwells in you. You have incredible power, but the difference is we use our power not to serve ourselves, but we use our power to serve others. Christians consider others better than ourselves. God's people are a people who hunger and thirst for righteousness. We're a people who look at the injustice of racism. We look at it. We don't turn a blind eye to it. We look at it. We look at the mistreatment of women in society. We look at the killing of the unborn, and we mourn. We mourn, but we don't just mourn. We fight to bring in righteousness and justice and mercy. We hunger and we thirst for it. Jesus said we're going to be a merciful people. When the rest of the world cries out for vengeance and payback and retribution, we're going to be different. In light of the mercy that we ourselves have received from Jesus, we're going to be a merciful people. Jesus said we're going to be pure in heart. What does this mean? When the unbelievers in this world are just giving away their hearts to anything and everything that promises them happiness, that promises them joy, to money, to sex, to men's empty praise, Jesus said that we're going to be pure in heart, that we're going to be unmixed in our affections, that we're going to be not ruled by many masters, but we're going to be ruled by only one master. Jesus said we're going to be peacemakers. Now, we're going to win people, not with Twitter wars, not with Facebook rampage, but with gentleness and kindness, through hospitality, not through anonymous insulting, as we invite people into our lives, into our homes. In the last beatitude, Jesus taught that even after living in this way, if the world doesn't embrace us with open arms, but instead persecutes us for loving Jesus and calls us closed-minded and bigoted and stupid and hateful for following the commands in this word that we call the Bible, that we're going to be a rejoicing people. Rejoicing in the midst of suffering, right? The world knows nothing about rejoicing in the midst of suffering. This is one of the distinguishing marks of a believer, that we are people, even when we suffer, we know how to rejoice because we know that God works all things for the good of those who love him, who have been called according to his purpose. That pain too, that suffering too, that he's yielding in you your goodness, your perfection, God's glory. And all of this, we're reflecting our King Jesus, who, though he was reviled, he did not revile in return. When he suffered, he didn't threaten. He said, Father, forgive them, for they know not what they do. This kind of living just might change the world. Mariners Church, I know in so many ways you're already doing this. And I'm here to encourage you today, just keep going. Just keep going, and whatever you're doing, do more. Do more because he's worth it, amen? Jesus is worth it, do more. And so first, when Jesus calls us salt, he's saying church, because we've been called out of sin and death, because we are God's sons and daughters. We're called to live a distinct and set apart life in accord with the Beatitudes. If we're the same as the world that's decaying, we won't be able to help the world. But here's the second point. While Christians are to be distinct and set apart from the world, we cannot separate ourselves from the world. While we're living differently from the world, we're called not to be indifferent towards the world. Why do I say that? Because Jesus said, Matthew 5:13, you are the salt of the earth. Not just you are the salt, but you are the salt of the earth. Pastor Tony Evans down there in Dallas, he said, you are the salt of the earth, not the salt of the salt shaker. In other words, as long as the salt just stays in the salt shaker, right? It can't do the good that it can do. If the salt is not rubbed into the wound, it can't heal. If I'm trying to eat my steak dinner and I take a bite and it tastes a little bland, right? And I think to myself, oh, it must be because the salt shaker is way over there and I just bring it close. Will that do any good? No, if I just bring it closer, just centimeters away from my bland steak, will that make my steak taste good? No, not unless the salt is poured out, right? Unless the salt is poured out, it can't help my steak, right? Too many times, we're just centimeters away from the people that desperately need Jesus. Just centimeters away, right? As we go grocery shopping, as we sit across cubicles, as we sit on an airplane, just centimeters away from people that don't know Jesus. I've never heard of the hope that we have in Jesus. But we're so afraid. For some reason, we're so afraid. We've been recipients of the greatest news ever, right? All of us would sit around and say, the greatest thing that could ever happen to a person has happened to me. And yet we're so afraid to engage, start the conversation, right? We're of no use. We're of no use to a world that's perishing unless we pour ourselves out. Unless we pour ourselves out. And so as long as Christians are staying in its Christian bubble and its Christian huddle, we can't bring any healing to a hurting world. We can't prevent the decay of today's society. And we can't bring out the best in today's culture and make it flourish. Salt is a penetrating commodity. That's what it does. Salt is a penetrating commodity. It's powerless if it remains in the salt shaker. You see, the enemy is just fine with us being salt in here. We know how to be salt in here. Kind to each other, ask each other how we're doing. We forgive, right? We know how to be salt in here. The enemy is fine with us being salt in here, so as long as we're not salt out there. John Stott, your Pastor Kenton's mentor, says, preaching on this text, he says, of course, it's good to come to church, so as long as you don't do it too often. I have a funny way to say that, right? Of course, it's good to come to church, so as long as you don't do it too often, but it's true. Christians should gather. Christians, we need to gather, but Christians, we can't stay gathered. We can't stay gathered or we'll be of no use to a world that's perishing and it's decaying. So on the one hand, we must be distinct and set apart. If we're just like the world and not any different, we won't be able to help the world. But on the other hand, if we live just private and isolated lives, if we stay in the salt shaker, we won't be of any use either. As Christians, we have a real hard time keeping both of these callings, don't we? Some of us, that we have a hard time keeping this calling, but that first calling we keep really well. Some of us in Christianity at one extreme are isolating ourselves and our family from anything of this world, right? You don't own a TV, you don't watch rated R movies, you only listen to Christian radio stations, you homeschool your kids, you only eat at Chick-fil-A and not any of those other heathen restaurants, right? Now, Angela and I, we homeschool our kids, and I could eat Chick-fil-A for days, right? These things aren't bad, they're good. Not watching rated R movies just might help you to fight pornography out of your life. All these things are good, but it becomes dangerous if the reason we do these things, if the reason we do these things is so that we can isolate ourselves and escape from the world that we're called into. But I'm called to holiness, you might be saying. I need to protect my family from all the evil in this world, you might be saying. But think about this. Jesus lived an absolutely sinless, holy, and set apart life, didn't he? But he lived this holy and set apart life in such a way that caused the prostitutes and tax collectors to just want to be near him, right? the calling isn't just to live a holy life. The calling is to live a holy life as we're being rubbed into the societies and the cultures of this world. Jesus lived this righteous and set apart life while having dinner with prostitutes and tax collectors. Now, on the other hand, some of you do a really good job at obeying the second calling. You want to be so understanding. You want to be able to empathize with the unbelievers in this world. And so you've decided that the best way to do that is just become like the world. Do what they do. Watch what they watch. Laugh at the same jokes. Pursue the same things. In the same way, you have no problem being rubbed into the world, but you've lost your what? You lost your distinctiveness. You've lost your saltiness. You've so engrossed yourself into today's entertainment industry, for instance. Now, sometimes I find myself watching an entire movie. It had so many cuss words in it, but it didn't ping me, right? Because I've become so desensitized to it. Some of us, we could sit through an entire hour-long TV show in which 20 minutes of it were sex scenes, and you sat through it all without even blushing, without even being uncomfortable. Jeremiah 6 talks about a people who become so intertwined with the world that they've forgotten how to blush. Church, have we forgotten how to blush? Both extremes are wrong, aren't they? A challenge of the believer is learning how to obey both callings, learning to live the way that Jesus lived, distinct and set apart, but oh so rubbed into the lives of the poor, into the lives of the marginalized, into the lives of the sexually promiscuous and the greedy, money-loving people. Jesus ate with them. Church, are we eating with them? And as we're eating with them, are we different? Are we different? And so what is Jesus teaching us by calling us salt? He's teaching us we are to be distinct from the world, but not to separate from the world. And here's the last point, so that we can change the world, so that we can fearlessly change the world. John Stott, in his sermon, he asked this question in his sermon. He asked, can we change society? Can we change a society? Of course, we believe that individual human beings can change, but can a society change? Can Irvine, can Newport change? Can Orange County change? Let's think about our national culture, its consensus on moral questions, its view of marriage and sex and the family, its attitude towards human life and its sanctity. Think about the administration of its justice, its treatment of the poor, its care for human rights, especially in regards to women and minorities and immigrants. These are the things that make up a nation's moral culture. Now, today's society, our national culture, can't ever be perfect. That's not the goal. Until Jesus returns and creates a new heaven and a new earth, there will be no perfect kingdom here. But the question is, okay, the world's culture can't ever be perfectly just, but can it be more just? Can't ever be perfectly merciful, but can it be more merciful? Can it be more compassionate? Can it be more pleasing to God? You may be saying, no, it can never change. It's too far gone. The people in charge are too evil. The system is too corrupt. The people are too divided, right? Just look around. Things aren't getting any better. They're getting worse. Just look at the news. Have you scrolled through social media? Do you know what's happening in middle school these days? It's not getting better. It's getting worse. Yes, you're exactly right. And Jesus knew it would be this way. And so that's why he said, you're the salt. You're the salt of the earth. He's saying, yes, the world is decaying and salt is what it needs. And church, Mariners, you are the salt that the world needs. You're that salt. Christians are not pessimists. We're a deeply hopeful people. We look at anything, no matter how dark, no matter how seemingly evil, we look at it and we say, Jesus can change that too. After all, he's changed me. After all, he's changed me. We look at anything. We say, Jesus can change anything. We're a hopeful people. Listen, if you put salt in meat or on fish, something happens. Something is bound to happen. The bacterial decay is hindered. If you put salt on a wound, something happens. Salt acts as an antiseptic, and healing takes place. And so who is to blame for a society that is deteriorating? Whose fault is it? We can name a lot of people, right? It's the government's fault. It's the media's fault. It's the fault of the rich. It's the fault of the poor. It's the fault of the conservatives, fault of the liberals. We can go on and on and on, right? But based upon what Jesus is saying here, let me propose something, church. If society is decaying, maybe, just maybe, it's our fault. Maybe it's our fault. Maybe it's the fault of the Christian that's lost their distinctive saltiness. Maybe it's the fault of the church who's refusing to venture into the dark and ugly places of this city. Maybe it's our fault. You remember back in Genesis when God looked down on Sodom and Gomorrah because of its evil, because of its corruption and decay, and he said he would destroy it. And Abraham, knowing his nephew Lot lived there, he intercedes on behalf of Sodom. He says in Genesis 18, verse 23, then Abraham drew near and said, will you indeed sweep away the righteous with the wicked? Suppose there are 50 righteous within the city. Will you then sweep away the place and not spare it for the 50 righteous who are in it? Far be it from you to do such a thing, to put the righteous to death with the wicked, so that the righteous fare as the wicked. Far be that from you. Shall not the judge of all the earth do what is just? And the Lord said, if I find that Sodom 50 righteous in the city, I will spare the whole place for their sake. And Abraham, in his shrewdness, asks, okay, what about 45, God? About 40, 30? 20, 10, right? Angela gets so embarrassed with me sometimes because I try to negotiate everything, and I'm like, it's godly to negotiate, right? Christians who are salt, who are distinct and set apart in their living, but who are also rubbed into the society, will have a preserving impact upon the society that God would otherwise destroy. This text is showing us that just by Christians, living as Christians in a city, right? Just by being salt in the city, no matter how corrupt, no matter how sinful that city, just because God's people are present and being salt, God will extend mercy towards it. He will give it more time. Well, what about Lot, you might be asking? Lot and his family were there, right? What about them? They were rubbed into that society, right? But they did Sodom no good because they had become so intertwined with Sodom that they had lost their distinct saltiness. Well, how do we know? Because when the angels try to rescue Lot out of Sodom, this is what it says, Genesis 19, verse 15. As morning dawned, the angels urged Lot, saying, up, take your wife and your two daughters who are here, lest you be swept away in the punishment of the city. But he lingered, it says. But he lingered. So the men seized him and his wife and his two daughters by the hand, the Lord being merciful to him. And they brought him out and set him outside the city. But he lingered, it says. He hesitated. And later on, we see his wife looking back longingly at the city that she has to leave behind. And God turning her into what? Interestingly enough, a pillar of salt. Perhaps serving as a preserving agent for all of God's people of the consequences that we too will face if our being too intertwined with the world proves us not just in the world, but of the world. And so we shouldn't be shaking our heads and looking disapprovingly and disgustingly at what's happening in our world. Jesus said, we're the salt. We're the salt of the earth. We're the solution to a decaying world. If we're looking at the world and rottenness and woundedness abound, there's only two possible reasons for it. Either we're not living distinct and set apart lives, or we are living an isolated, privatized Christianity. We're keeping our faith a secret. We're salt that's staying in the salt shaker. The major failure of the church throughout its long history has either been to withdraw from the world in monastic seclusion or to conform to the world and embrace its values and standards. If we withdraw from the world, we can't help it. If we conform to the world, we can't help it. Only if we can combine together this distinctness and this entering in, it's this combination that makes salt manifest. Only then can we hope to change the world. In conclusion, all of this language about being distinct and set apart and yet entering in to a decaying world ought to sound very familiar to Christians. Right? Who does this remind you of? Who did this very thing that we as a church are called to do? Well, 2,000 years ago, a baby was born in Bethlehem lay wrapped in swaddling clothes in a manger. He was born into this broken and decaying world, though he was not of this world. Jesus is the one who was truly distinct and set apart, wasn't he? But he didn't keep his distinctness separate from us. Jesus entered in, and that's what the gospel is all about. He was heaven's son. In him was the worth. In him was the value and the power to save. But if he stayed apart from us, if he stayed away from us, none of that power, none of that worth would have done us any good. He had to come into our world, be rubbed into our decaying world, our rotting lives, and at a great cost to himself, he did. Though he was the King of Kings, though he was distinct and set apart as the King of Kings, he had to become poor for us. Though he was Almighty God himself, he had to become weak for us and be exposed to our shame, be exposed to our frailties, be exposed to our sins. Though he was perfectly holy, though he knew no sin, at the cross he had to become sin for us. Though he is set apart as the only begotten Son of God, in whom the Father was well pleased, he had to be forsaken for us. Though he was the uncreated one, though he was the author of life itself, he had to taste of death for us. That was the price. That was the cost of his entering in. And he paid it. And he paid it, church. Not only that, he gladly paid it. He gladly paid it for you, for me. It was both his distinctness from us and his absolute unwillingness to separate himself from us that saved us. And so, church, like King Jesus, who has gone before us, let us be distinct. Let us be set apart as sons and daughters of God. And as long as God allows, let us be oh so unwilling to separate ourselves from this world that desperately needs Jesus, so that we can point them to this great salvation, so that we can point them to this great gospel, so that we can point them to this great Jesus. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you for your grace. We thank you for your grace upon grace upon grace. The world is decaying, Lord. The world is truly rotting away. And it hasn't caught you by surprise. You knew it would be this way. You knew what the condition of the world would be in which we are called into as a church. And yet you called us into it and said, "You're the salt. You're the salt. You're my sons. You're my daughters. You can bring out the world's best, and you can prevent them from their worst tendencies. You can prevent them from their worst sins, and you could cause them to return by the power of the gospel." Father, thank you for Jesus. Though he was set apart, though he was Almighty God, though he was the Prince of Heaven, he came. He came. Wrapped himself in human flesh. He entered into our world and into our lives, and he changed everything. So in light of this magnificent, this King Jesus who had entered into the world and into our lives, Lord, will you make us a distinct and set apart people? And will you give us an unwillingness to separate from this world that desperately needs you? And so, church, what is God calling you to do? Is he calling you to be distinct and set apart? Is he calling you to be more salty? Over the years, have you found yourself becoming more intertwined with the things in this world? Are you becoming more and more and more like the thing that's decaying? Is he calling you to be more distinct, set apart? Or is he calling you to get in there? Is he calling you to be rubbed into your neighborhood, your schools, your workplace? Is he calling you to start that conversation and engage your neighbor and invite them over to dinner and share the gospel. Father, I pray for this church that you love so much. Father, I ask that you would call them to this kind of life. Father, that you would call them to be the salt in Irvine, Newport, Orange County, California. Father, that you would use them to be the salt of the earth, and by this church, through this church, that you would change the world, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Let's stand together and sing to this God who calls us his children, who loves us, who transforms us, shapes us, and molds us to be salt and light in the earth. Let's declare his greatness.
Great.
Bible Church. Would you thank Pastor Halim for bringing God's word, sharing it with us this morning? Thank you for loving our people, loving God's word. Just a reminder that these are invite cards. They're available for you as you make your way from this place. Be sure to invite your neighbors, your friends, your co-workers. Next week, Romans 8, best chapter ever. If you have a need for prayer, there's a team of people over here on this wall. They would love to pray for you. If you have a need for healing, our elders out these center doors and to your right would love to pray with you. If you would, extend your hand and receive a blessing as we go. Oh God, these are your people. These are your children. You love them. The salt and light of the earth. The spirit you receive does not make you slaves so that you live in fear again. Rather, the spirit you received brought about your adoption to sonship. And by him we cry, Abba, Father. The spirit himself testifies with our spirit that we are God's children. Would you cover our hearts and our minds in this truth? And we ask this in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Would you go in God's grace?